I was born in the midst of the Depression in Dallas, and then not long after that, we moved to a small town called Waxahachie, about 30 miles south of Dallas. And I, as a child, was severely dyslexic, although they did not know what dyslexia was in those days. And it was simply thought that I was a very nice kid, but I was slow. And I lived in the bottom one percentile of my class. I spent every summer in summer school. I doubt if I would have made it through high school if my mother hadn't played bridge with many of the high school teachers, and it would have broken up the bridge game if they had flunked me. What I couldn't do early on was read. My attention span was very short when it came to reading. But I could draw. It was a left brain, right brain issue. So the drawing, I could keep my attention focused for 20, 30, 40 minutes. But reading, it was only a matter of a minute at the most. And so I began to draw, I would say now as a kind of therapy, but then nobody knew it. I drew because it felt good to draw. And if you do something often enough, you get good at it. I don't think I was ever good enough, ever, to have been a functioning real artist. But I was good enough that I could take a positive sense of identity from drawing. And I covered the walls of my family's house with my drawings. And my parents did not know, nor did they care about creativity. It was in the middle of the Depression. That was the last thing on anybody's agenda. But what they did know is they did understand desperation on the face of their child. And so they let me do that. And what it, the great lesson that they both taught me was that love and patience can conquer almost anything, almost anything. And I think I certainly tested both of those qualities in them because I was both hyperactive and slow at the same time. But slowly, I sort of found a way to limp through school. And my father, for reasons that don't bear going into, was not a socially outgoing person. And so he would come home from work, and instead of saying, "Have you done your homework?" which any sensible father would have done, he said, "Would you like to go to the movies?" And of course I chose the movies every time. And we would see two or three movies a week. And this is in the days of radio before television. And on the weekends, I would see a couple of three movies over the weekend. And I, as I think I said before, over the years, I learned narrative from movies, not from reading. I still could not write a novel. I once wrote a short story when I was in college that somebody had to sort of rewrite it for me because I couldn't spell or punctuate. And it was about a boy that I had met in this little town in Texas who was from a very strict fundamentalist religious group, and he was never allowed to go to movies. I couldn't believe somebody wasn't allowed to go to the movies. So I wrote a story about this boy who went to a movie, and he remained transfixed by that movie. And he stayed and watched that same movie again and again through the day. And the next morning he showed up at the theater and he watched it again. For him, there was only one movie. And when the movie left the town, he followed the movie to whatever town it went to. And he spent his life until that movie sort of crumbled, you know, seeing only one movie, thinking that was all he needed.
You wrote this story?
I wrote this story, and when I was in college. And I wanted to be able to write, but I couldn't. And to not be able to read and have the ambition to write is suicidal. But it got better. And as I was in college, I fell in love with a girl who wanted to write, and I followed her into and we went out together, and I followed her into this basic history of Western literature course. And to try, for someone who's dyslexic, to try to read Magic Mountain by Thomas Mann in 3 weeks was one of the most horrific things of my life. And all I can remember about it to this day is that Hans Castor would smoke one cigar in the morning in his sanitarium, in that sanitarium in Switzerland. But I would still go to movies. We would go to movies all the time. And movies assumed increasingly a more important role in my life, although I never thought about making them. I can remember seeing Singing in the Rain and thinking, this is a perfect work of art. There's nothing wrong. That was one thing wrong with this movie. There's not one thing wrong with it. It is that complete and perfect in itself.
Yes.
And I can remember sitting in a theater in Waxahachie when I was a senior in high school with my father. And we went to see a movie by John Huston called The Asphalt Jungle. If you've seen enough movies, you begin to remember the names of directors.
Yeah.
You begin to remember the names of writers. You begin getting a lot more information than you think you're getting.
So you read credits.
I could read credits.
You could read credits.
I could read credits, but they only lasted about a minute, okay.
Well,
that was my attention span for reading. And Asphalt Jungle, Huston had just come back from the military, where he'd made those two incredible documentaries, Something for Light and The Thing of Battle of San Remo. And the first 5 minutes of Asphalt Jungle are like a neorealist film. They're shot like a documentary. I had never seen any of that in my life. And then after that, it goes back into being a normal kind of expressionist film, the way he shot Maltese Falcon. But the movie ended, my father, let's go. And I said, no. And I watched that movie a second time, straight through it, because I couldn't. It so moved me in a way I couldn't describe. I had not the words to say why it moved me, but it moved me. And over the years, the movies never ceased to pull me into them. When I first came to New York, I think I saw Place in the Sun by George Stevens, Montgomery Clift, and Elizabeth Taylor, and Shelley Winters. I think I saw it 13 or 14 times.
Wow.
And I was living in New York then with two roommates. We lived on East 49th Street between 2nd and 3rd. Across the street, we lived in an apartment. We had no furniture except Army cots that we got in the Army Navy store. But we were across the street from Katharine Hepburn. And on 3rd Avenue, you know, it was the L, and there was a theater there called the Beverly Theater. And it was playing Place in the Sun at that point. And I was going to Columbia News today, and I had a job from 5 until 10 at night. And if I did it right, I could get there after the job just in time to catch the last show of Place in the Sun. And I was in the theater one day, and the lights went up at the end of the, and there were three people in the theater, and one of them was Katharine Hepburn. But you see a movie 13 and you begin to see the structure. First you go because of Elizabeth Taylor and that wonderful scene where they fall in love. I mean, that's just this incredibly lush, beautiful scene. But then you begin to notice the structure. You begin to notice that when Shelley Winters and Montgomery Clift have an argument when they go to get married, it's just outside of the room where he will be tried for her murder later. So you begin to see the structure that Stevens had in mind when he was doing it. And once you see that in one film, you begin to look for it in other films. It gives you an education in one sense, but it also gives you skill. And I was very lucky because there was no such thing as film school in those days. And I was, and art school was a kind of liberal education where it allowed me time to grow up. But I didn't have it in me to be a good artist.
Right.
And the art and the level that I that meant something to me.
Yeah.
But movies were something that I found without, before they had any cultural value. I found them because I just loved them. Because I mean, I come to believe that there are relatively few problems that were handed or dysfunctions that were given that don't have somewhere hidden in them a gift. And there are very few gifts that were given, or most of the gifts that were given, have hidden in themselves a terrible problem. I've learned more from my failures than I ever have from any success.
Well, that's,
success only teaches you a habit.
Right.
And
right.
That's not a good thing to learn.
You mentioned you wrote the story of this boy who went to the movies when you were younger, when you were in college. Were you in, do you reflect back on that now and ever think of yourself as having written your life?
I think that if I look back on what I've done, the stuff that I think has the most meaning for me is stuff that is, in some sense, has an autobiographical element. Biden Clyde, to the degree that I was one of four major contributors to it, I would say David and I did the screenplay together. Warren and Arthur were huge. They were like extraordinary partners in this. Bob Towne's contribution was huge. Dee Dee Allen was incredibly important in the writing of that film. Altman used to say, your last chance to rewrite is in the editing. And Dee Dee Allen was one of the great editors who ever lived. Not to mention Warren as an actor, Gene Hackman, Faye, and Estelle Parsons. They were, I mean, it's in that sense, I can't imagine that picture without all of those people being in place.
Well, you did imagine that picture before you met them. And you
wrote but the picture that we wrote then was specifically written for Francois Truffaut.
Right.
And it's written to be a kind of American version of a combination of Jules and Jim and Shoot the Piano Player. Sometimes what you're given isn't what you ask for, it's what you need. Warren, I think I can't imagine a better person to have worked, to both produced and acted in that film than Warren. And I think he understood it on some level from a different point of view than David and I did. But he understood something about it that brought a depth into it, as Arthur did. They added a depth and a resonance to what we had done. I'm not taking away from what we did. I'm not taking away from that at all. But both of those people, in very important ways, made it a much better film than it was a screenplay. I've seen very few perfect screenplays in my life. I think Chinatown by Robert Towne is as close as I know to a perfect screenplay. I suspect Godfather 2 is a perfect screenplay as well. But those are great screenplays. Great, great screenplays. We had never written anything before, a screenplay before. David was an editor, Esquire. I was the art director. As I said, I'm dyslexic. I can't spell. I can't punctuate. I did, in my family, we have a very suspect gene pool for choosing exactly the wrong thing to do. And this was very close to that. And why it worked out, where it had no reason for it to work out, I don't know. But I remember thinking, We both were talking, spent our time talking about movies. And in the early 60s, it was the first group of new wave films to hit in the United States, along with directors like Fellini, along with Bergman. There was an enormous sense of a vitality in European film that didn't exist in American film, with the exception of Arthur Penn and Kazan and Frankenheimer and Mulligan. There were not that many, and Peckinpah. There were not that many people doing really, not, American film was moribund at that point. And it took 4 years to 3 years to sell Bonnie and Clyde. And we would have never anticipated that it would have had the response that it had. We would never in this world have predicted. I knew when we saw the first cut of it that it was really good. I knew that it was really good, better than I ever expected it to be. And I think that was because I knew all of us, it was a perfect working group together. That doesn't mean there weren't quarrels and arguments, although David and I didn't have any with anybody. But there were arguments between Arthur and Warren throughout it, but it never showed on the screen.
So,
and it was a great sense of a collaboration. That picture is not due to any of one person. I never thought of myself as a writer, or as a pretty good writer. And I remember the first days of beginning to work, I was going down in those days on 6th Avenue between 42nd and 44th Street, there was a group of used magazine stores. And I was going down to get detective magazines that had stories about Bonnie and Clyde for research. And I remember thinking, look, I don't know, I can't spell, I can't punctuate. I took one creative writing course in college and I flunked that. But Dave knows how to write, and I can listen to criticism. If I can listen to criticism openly, I can make it better. And then somebody else can create it and it can better, and sooner or later it will be good enough to sell. The only thing I have to worry about is my own despair. If I can keep myself from giving up, then I'll be okay. And that's as true today as it was then.
Indeed. I want to go back. You mentioned John Huston as being key. Mm-hmm. Did you get to meet John Huston?
No, I never met Huston. I met Hitchcock once briefly for lunch. I met Hitchcock twice. Once when I was at Esquire, and then once briefly for lunch with Peter Bogdanovich. I never met Billy Wilder. I barely met Billy Wilder once, but that was very late in life. I never got to meet Peckinpah. I never got to meet Hawks.
But you met Truffaut, Godard.
I met Truffaut, Godard. I met Truffaut, Godard, Leone, Fellini. You know, I never met Bergman. I met Antonioni.
Is there a single mentor, or speak about mentorship?
I think I got started. Dave and I got started trying to write a European film. And then we went to work with Joe Mankiewicz, and we had written a prison western, which was an unlikely film for him to do. And we spent a year working with him, and he taught us a lot. And then we worked with Bogdanovich, but somewhere in that process, David decided he wanted to direct. And I knew that meant the end of the partnership. Because I'm not the kind of person who could have produced.
You're not the
David's
person who?
The kind of person who could have produced, nor is David inclined to produce.
What is the kind of person who can produce?
Well, someone who can sit and make aesthetic judgments of other people's script and deal with money, bringing in money and hiring. I mean, I just don't have an organized mind. I've an organized imagination, but not an organized mind. And And I knew that would be the end of the partnership. And we were not only partners, we were best friends. And it was the only time we ever had a fight, but bad fight. I really didn't want that to happen. And he prevailed. So I said, okay, if you're going to direct, I'm going to direct. He had no problem with me directing. So I said, somebody suggested that we do two screenplays, one of which David would choose a subject matter that he wanted to direct, that we would write together, because we had a name together, not by ourselves. And I would choose a picture that I wanted to direct, and we would write that together. So we wrote one, and I didn't want to direct. So what I did is I picked a subject matter that was it was when they were still doing Westerns. It was a very cheap movie to make. It was with young kids in the middle of the prairie, going west at the time of the Civil War. And I thought, okay, you can make this movie cheaply. Somebody will make this movie. Nobody in their right mind will let me direct. In the meantime, David will get over this idea of directing, and we'll go back to being screenwriting partners, as we should be doing, and have a reasonable life. And of course, there is this rule in Hollywood. If you want something, they will not let you have it. No matter how talented you are, now, if you want it, they can smell it and they won't give it to you. If you don't give a shit, if you don't care about it, they'll throw it at you. So, partly because the picture I had wanted to direct, or nominally wanted to direct, was cheap, and partly for whatever reasons, they called and asked if we would sell it to him. And if David had not been in the office that day, I would have never mentioned directing. That's the truth. But because he was there, I said, and because I'd made an issue of it, I said, well, I'm attached as a director. And there was this long pause, and he said, well, can we have a drink and talk about it? I was waiting for him to say no. So we had a drink with some executive at Paramount, and a very nice man. And he said, well, have you ever directed? I said, saying no. I've been waiting for him to say, no, you're nuts, you know? But they went away and they came back and they said, would I do a test? So we had done a screenplay for Bud York and Norman Lear. Hmm. And their picture never got made, but I called, but Bud and Norman had become friends. And I called Bud and he said, oh, fine, I'll walk you through it. Don't worry, I'll tell you how to do it. I'll tell you which scenes to pick, and I'll walk you through and tell you what to do. So I said, and I'm stuck. I didn't want to do this. I'm stuck saying, I'm going to do this screen test to direct. In the meantime, David and I were in California doing a version of a draft of a rewrite, a polish of a draft of What's Up, Doc, for Bogdanovich. And we had a great time. We work at the Peter during the day, and we go in the evenings, we get pizza and soft drinks and go to Warner Brothers and watch Preston Sturges movies or Lubitsch movies. It was just a great way to work. And when that was done, I went off to do this screen test. I didn't know how to do it. I didn't know what to do, but Bud Joe said, here's what you have to do, and I learned enough from him. If you go back and look at that picture, it is a picture about a friendship.
This picture being?
The Bad Company.
Bad Company.
It's a picture about a friendship. Yes. It's about the partnership. And as witness, the central character, his name is Drew, which is past tense of draw, which is what I used to do. And you could see a lot about our relationship in it, okay? It was in that sense, very, not literally autobiographical, but it drew on that. So we hired the actors. One was John Ritter, just for the test. And the other was Barry Brown, who actually did it in the film. And I went I drove in the hotel to the Paramount that morning, and that was when Paramount had a Western Street burned down a few years later. And I remember thinking, this will teach me not to lie. I'm going to go out, I'm making a total fool of myself, humiliate myself in front of people. It's going to be awful. And I got there, and I knew what I was going to do. We laid track. The first thing was a long tracking shot. And after about an hour, I thought, if I don't do this for the rest of my life, I don't think I can stand it. Now, it wasn't the power, which I promise you, 90% of directing is about damage control.
90% is about?
No, about damage control.
Damage control.
It wasn't about power, and it wasn't about seeing my vision realized. Any number of people could have done it as well or better than me. It was that I got an instinct on that day, on that test, that this crew was a kind of family. That it's a temporary family. That it lasts for 8 or 10 or 12 weeks or 14, whatever winning week, but with all the frictions and all the dysfunctions of a family, but it's a family. It's a very intense relationship. And it seemed to me that that family of a movie crew was so necessary to me, if that makes any sense. It's nothing I verbalized at the time. It's just as I've thought about why I did a 180, why it suddenly mattered to me that I get to direct this picture. It wasn't about being a director in any conventional way of being a director. It really wasn't. It wasn't about seeing my vision through. There is for me a thing of walking onto a set. When you're in the middle of shooting, it's home. Fellini once said, every soundstage in the world smells the same. And I think that's true. There is a family in a larger sense than a conventional family. It's big, sprawling, and unruly, but it's a family.
It's interesting because you said just now, the family nature of the people you work with on the film and the temporary nature of that. And it struck me because, just to jump to Kramer versus Kramer for a moment, Dustin Hoffman speaks about how that's precisely what he told young Justin Henry in order to evoke tears when Justin was, that wonderful scene where he falls and wonderfully gripping scene, and Ted picks up his son and runs to the hospital to get this brilliant young child who was playing the part of a kid. I don't even want to say actor. He was that child. To get him to cry, Dustin Hoffman said to him basically what you were talking about now. He talked about the temporariness of life on the film set.
And I mean, there's a ruthlessness in this. It's an awful thing to do to a child to say, you know, it's going to be over tonight. I'll probably never see you again. It's a terrible thing to do to a child in real life. But you're willing to do it to get that child for that moment to have a life beyond his own life, and which is that little boy crying. Dustin, on that last day or so, it was shot in sequence. And that last day, he said, you know, Justin Henry was the young actor's name. You know, I'm probably, you know, this is going to be the last day we shoot together today. And and Dustin was great with him during the whole, we worked out a system because I said, that boy has to believe you're his father. And therefore, when I have a direction for him, your I'm going to tell you and you're going to tell him. I'm going to be like the grandparent, but you're going to be the parent. And one of the most wonderful scenes in the picture is a scene that Dustin had in his mind that happened to Dustin. He went in and he blocked it out roughly with Justin in the morning when I got there. He said, listen, I know this is, you, I know you can say no, but don't say no until you've seen it. And it was, I had a scene about a soldier, he had a scene about ice cream. And it was brilliant. Who could in their right mind would have said no to that? And it was so good that, that's what I mean. It's not that it's not that you control everything.
Right.
It's that you listen wisely to the people around you and you hire people who are really smart. I once, before I started directing, I thought, how am I going to get people to talk normally, not to act all the time? And it occurred to me, you just hire good actors. That's what they know how to do. You know how to tell somebody to do that. You hire a good actor and trust them. And I think that's, it's part of it is trusting people and letting them make mistakes. Not trying to correct all the details. When I worked as the assistant to the art director of Esquire, one of the best jobs I ever had, a guy came in with an illustration. And it was okay, it wasn't terrible, it wasn't as good as the guy normally did. And when the guy, and the art director said, terrific, that's great, good, okay, you know. And I said to him after the illustrator left, did you like that? He said, not particularly. I said, well, why didn't you make him do it again? He said, because if I did, he'd always be working for me, not for himself. And I'm gambling on the fact that he's, in the long run, gonna ask more out of himself than I'll ever ask out of him. And that's what you want, that you want to let people know they have, trust people, trust actors, trust cinematographers, trust editors, trust writers, that you hire them because at some moment they're going to have a better idea than you're going to have. And you, it's not going to have, every idea is not going to be better, but you keep yourself open to those ideas. I mean, Dustin's that scene with the ice cream is a brilliant scene. And I didn't, I just said, okay, do it, that's fine. I said, action cut, you know. But I was smart enough to know that somebody had a better idea than I had.
Yeah, it's that seems sort of counterintuitive in Hollywood or in show business. Somebody has a better idea than I, to be able to say that. One of the questions here is, you know, about moving to Hollywood and Hollywood, but Hollywood is a mythical place, mm-hmm. you know, and it's a point on the map. How do you stay open? How do you stay receptive and honest?
Sometimes I don't. You know, my batting average is probably less than 500. You know, no.
Sometimes I don't.
Sometimes I don't. Sometimes I've been lucky. Sometimes I haven't. But no, sometimes I try to. But sometimes my ear isn't that good. My judgment's not that good. I mean, you want to sit and talk about on the mistakes I've made? There's a lot.
But you've learned from them.
Huh?
But you learn from them.
I've learned from some of them. Some of them I'm afraid I keep making. You know, I mean, his object is to try not to think the same mistake twice.
Right.
Or at least try desperately not to make it a third time.
What relationship have you struggled with the most in your career, artistically, with somebody? What was the most difficult relationship you've had that proved to be the most...
I think the hardest...
Creative.
...relationship... To end when David and I ended our working relationship, that was the hardest thing for me, because the families lived in one building for a long time. We were incredibly close for a while. And then inevitably life pulled us away from one another.
Right.
And not only that, but I had to learn to write on my own. And David, I learned to write by copying David's style. I still write in a certain kind of way I learned from copying David.
You're still collaborating with David Newman.
Yeah, I mean, I'm in that sense, it was a huge influence on me. And the fear of writing on my own. And it was so hard. It was so hard. And I missed the friendship, still do. I missed the, and I love it. One of the great things about working with Richard Russo is that he's terrific to work with. He's just great. I mean, we have such a good time together, and he's so smart, and I trust him so much. There's a scene in Twilight between Paul Newman and Gene Hackman after Gene Hackman's had this heart attack. And he's found out that Newman has slept with his wife. A scene between these two men that's just, it's gold, and it's all Richard's. It's just Richard's, and it's so smart, and so good, and so, with such a sense of depth to it. And I think, wow, am I lucky to have a partner, a writing partner like that? It's terrific.
And that scene, it's remarkable because it does two things at once. It actually shows the closeness of their relationship, but it pivots on a betrayal
mm-hmm.
of the most profound kind.
Yeah. But Richard understands those kind of relationships. And the great thing about Richard as a writer, separate from me, as a writing partner, he has a great sense of empathy.
Because
you could not have, you had to love both those characters and understand that both those men really loved one another, you know, and that he's brilliant at that. I mean, I think if you're writing with a partner, you have to have the same goal. Not just the story, you can have various ideas about the story. Those can all be fixed. But to write with a partner, you must know where emotionally you want to end up. I cannot write a film, and I've tried it a lot of times, and it doesn't work, unless I know what the last scene is. If I know the last scene, then I roughly know where I'm going. If I'm going, it's whether it's a matter of leaving New York on a train, going to San Diego or Seattle, because they're different journeys. And I've got to know that my ticket says is stamped San Diego or whatever. But I've got to know that for my own sense of feeling my way along that trip.
And how does that? What does that have to do with collaboration and partnership?
Well, because you both have to agree on that. You may not state it in words, but you have to have an instinct that you both know where you want to end up.
So that's the frequency you tune to. You look at a point in the distance, you and a partner.
Yeah.
And you say, I want to get there, you want to get there.
I may say Seattle and he may say Portland. But you're close enough that that's not going to be a problem.
Uh-huh.
And that you don't, and you never talk about it directly. But you have a sense about it that you know that you're going to the same place.
It's kind of like a road trip.
Yeah, it is like a road trip.
And it you is like a road try trip. To stay in the same car.
Yeah, it's true. Writing, you must know this as well as any human being, that writing, there are times where writing is just banging your head against the wall and writing by yourself especially. And there is something locked that won't unlock. And suddenly, sometimes almost of its own volition, it just gets tired of resisting you and it unlocks. And that moment where a scene opens up is one of the most, where you see it and you sense it, is one of the most thrilling parts of writing for me. I've been working on the script now. And it's gotten, I'm four-fifths of the way through. And there's this one area, and it just seemed like a swamp. And I've tried to skirt past it. I've tried to go and keep on you and work around. It wouldn't, doesn't work. Because unless I know what that is specifically, and I knew something was wrong. And at some point yesterday, I'm going to figure out what was wrong with that scene. I don't know, the picture, man, I mean, I don't know, but I mean, right now I figure out what was wrong with that scene. It wasn't all what I thought was wrong with it. And then it fit. And that's a moment where writing seems like the most privileged thing to do in the world.
Now, that this is a script you wrote.
This is a script I'm writing right now.
By yourself?
By myself.
And as you were struggling with that moment that wasn't quite fitting, were you crying out for Richard or David?
Yeah. I would have, but this was not, this was something that was this is something that drew on certain personal parts of my own life. And it wasn't something that I felt I could go to somebody else yet. When I finish with this, when I get all the way to the end of this, then I'll give it to Richard. I'll give it to about four people, and they'll give me notes, and that'll be great. And then I'll start on the next part of the process. One of the things that helped me more than anything is a thing I read in the Dramatists Guild Quarterly in, must have been the early 70s, that Neil Simon in an interview said that in doing The Odd Couple, he'd rewritten the poker scene something like 41 times. And he said the object wasn't how many times I rewrote it. The object was to get it right. And here's where I think there's a terrible problem that I think almost unsolvable. That the union has justifiably a thing that says you sign a contract. It says a first draft and a polish, a second draft and a polish or two polishes, and that's it. But at some point along the way, I can't do something like that. I can't do, I mean, I think 30, 40 times. I rewrote Kramer, I don't, God knows how many times. I did the first draft of Nobody's Fool. Scott Rudin looked at me and said, we can shoot this thing today. And I said, okay, I said, great. And 31 drafts later, we turned it into Paramount. But it was always necessary. I never argued with that. And yet, that, in some sense, against the union, and there should be some way in which what it takes to get it right isn't limited two drafts and two polish, three polishes. What it takes to get it right is to get it right.
Well, those are artificial dividing lines.
Yeah.
We all, I mean, to draw a map, you need to draw lines between states and countries. Yeah. And to draw distinctions in anything, you need to draw artificial lines. And as those are codified by unions and agents and managers, with a free flow of the artistic mind is without any start and stop. Any writer knows this. There's no such thing as a first draft, second draft, third draft. It's an ongoing.
It goes on and on and on and on and on.
There is one river, not a thousand drafts.
Yeah. And once you get into that river, you should, until you decide to get out, you should have a right to stay in that river.
So some structure is imposed on us.
But we have to have the right of our own volition to say, okay, I've accepted this structure, but I'm going to go beyond it, not because I'm forced to go beyond it, because I willingly choose to go beyond it. I think either you do it or you don't. And some people don't need it. Some people can do it and they get it right the first time. Although I've never met one.
How do you structure? I mean, structure in terms of business is important, and artists are notoriously unstructured there. How do you structure your time, your days, your writing?
I when I come in the office, I turn on the computer, I play one game of solitaire, and I open the I check to see if there's any mail. I don't answer any mail. And then I sit down and I start to work, and I go forward, and then I find myself having to go backwards. And then I keep going forward, and I move in a kind of crab-like way, because if you get to some point and you realize this isn't working because something earlier isn't working. So you go back and fix that, and then see if it works, and then see where that takes you. And I also think they're just certain crude tricks. And they don't apply to everyone.
No.
When I first started, a wonderful writer named David Zella Goodman, it's back when people used to, I was a long time ago, people used to call me Kid. And he said, Kid, I'm gonna give you, I was writing on my own. And I was scared to death. He said, I'll tell you what you do. You write a script, and in the first 30 pages, you write a scene, a killer scene for the lead actor. So when the actor reads it, he puts down the script, and he starts making up his Academy Award speech. Because you're not gonna get that picture made unless a bankable star wants to do it. And a bankable star, what they want is an Academy Award. You've gotta capture that actor's imagination. When you write a script, it seems to me it's partly a blueprint for a movie. It's partly an attempt to get financing for that movie, which includes getting bankable actors for that movie. And it is partly partly you have to pay attention to doing a movie that seems to be a responsible project. It doesn't cost any more to publish a book that's set in the Crusades than a book set in contemporary New York. But it costs a hell of a lot more to make a movie set in the Crusades than a movie set in New York. It takes 10,000 Indians on the hill. Sounds wonderful on a printed page. It's hell to do as a director. You don't want a 10,000, now yes, you can, because you can do it digitally, so you can write, you can go back to writing 10,000, you know.
Well, there's always a way to imply 10,000.
Exactly.
On a hill.
But there is, for all of the stuff that is about, however you deal with your imagination, there's something essentially much more pragmatic about a screenplay than about a novel. Because it's a novel's something that doesn't point to anything beyond itself. Somebody may make a movie, that's fine. But it's only what it is. It'll live or die as what it is. A screenplay has to point to the movie that lies beyond. A blueprint of a house is useless unless somebody builds the house.
Right.
And that's why a screenplay is a blueprint.
I want to go back briefly to Bud Yorkin and Norman Lear.
Mm-hmm.
This is a screenplay that I've read about, and you said it was something you very much
liked.
Yeah,
well, it was a wonderful screenplay called Hubba Hubba.
Hubba Hubba.
Yeah.
And Norman Lear, of course, revolutionized television with Bud Yorkin, yeah, and All in the Family. And they, at the time, they were doing movies like
Norman directed a wonderful picture, and they both have Cold been Turkey. Director on their own.
Cold Turkey was one of their movies.
Yeah.
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 And it was an inspired time, an inspiring time, yeah. You know, that you were situated in there, that's 60s,
yeah.
You know, as it swung into the 70s. Wow. What was the relationship with Bud Yorkin and Norman Lear like? And talk about Hubba Hubba, the screenplay that wasn't produced.
Okay. We met Bud and Norman when they were doing filming a movie called The Night That Raided Minsky's. They were shooting down at a Second Avenue theater. And they had an idea of taking Ferenc Molnár's The Play's the Thing and updating it as a contemporary thing. And we countered with, what if you set it in a sleazy studio, like Monogram Studios, in the 40s? And the conceit was that, and it would really follow roughly the plot of Play's the Thing, that the big comedy scene in this movie took place with the bombing of Pearl Harbor going on a radio in the background. And that was a really sort of sick thing to do. I mean, we didn't push the envelope, we just blew the envelope apart. And we had so much fun doing it. And they were great to work with. They never said, oh, you can't do that. And the more we did, the more they encouraged us to do it. And it was terrific. It was incredibly irreverent. That was really one of the best screenplays we ever did. You know, it was absolutely a phenomenally good screenplay.
Is it available?
I can try and find it. I don't know.
Should be, if I believe you when you say that, it should be published at least, if not produced.
Bud was trying to get it done, and I think it needs to be redone now. And I mean, and I think we. I don't mean completely redone, but I think it needs to be, you know, certainly. It was a terrific screenplay, as I recall. I haven't looked at it in 30 something years.
So that was
that experience of doing that, and the experience that David and I had doing What's Up, Doc. And What's Up, Doc, and I think What's Up, Doc is a very good movie, but I think without Buck Henry's participation, it would have been. Buck Henry sharpened it and made a terrific contribution to that. As I think Tom Mankiewicz did in Superman 1.
What is your relationship with Superman? How did that come about?
I think it was, we had been asked by Adams and Strauss to think about doing the book of a musical, because people were looking for people to do books for things. And David's son or his wife, someone suggested, why not do Superman as a musical? And it was at the beginning of that kind of pop art craze, and I think it was, it was fun to work on. It was in trouble from the time I went to Philadelphia, and my wife was very pregnant at the time. So it was a very hard time. I mean, we were just always playing catch up with that show. Got good reviews when it opened, and then just limped along and died in by the middle of summer. I know that when our son was born, we went to the theater. I went to give cigars out to the theater, and they said, we're not doing well, we're gonna have to go on, you know, limited royalties. And I thought, oh my God, this is not gonna be what we hoped it was gonna be. I'm gonna have to go back to honest work. And by that, and at that point, I don't think, no, Warren already bought, had already bought Bonnie and Clyde. And
but this was super, the play Superman
the,
was your
the
first
play Superman was the first
script.
The first script.
That you and David
And wrote. We worked on it for a year and a half. And he sort of limped along and died. And it was not, it was, I never was tempted from that to go back into the theater. I don't think I have a feeling for the theater. I really don't. I think the difference in writing for film and writing for theater is the difference in painting and sculpture. You know, you sit in the balcony of the theater and you sit in the first row, you see two different plays. You walk around the sculpture, you see something different. A movie is like a painting. Wherever you sit in the balcony, you sit in the front row, you still see roughly the same movie. And it's, I think I just had more of a sympathy with movies than I did for the theater.
And you got to then write Superman as a movie. Was writing the play part of what
No, writing the play, the movie was totally different from the play.
Well, I know.
They didn't even ask us, they didn't even know we'd written the play.
So
the Skulkins had no idea we'd written the movie.
Really?
No idea. And when we first did it, I was about to go off and do Late Show. And I had like 12 weeks before I went to work on Late Show. And as always, we needed money. So they said, would we meet the Salkins and do that? I said, okay, I could be 12 weeks. I give them whatever work I had to do in 12 weeks, which is a draft and a polish. Then David and Leslie, his wife, would do the second draft and the next polish. And so we all went to Paris. We stayed at the Georges V. And the Salkins, they wouldn't hire an office for us. We sat in the lobby of the Georges V with Guy Hamilton, who had directed Goldfinger, and one other Bond movie. He was going to do it. And we sat in the lobby, we worked it through, and every day at the end of the day, a representative from the Salkins would come by and hand us cash. It was the most bizarre working process I have ever been through in my life.
Also a non-guild structure.
Exactly, absolutely. But it was very pleasant, we had a nice time. And we did it, we turned in the end of work. I went off, and then David and Leslie completed it. And then Tom Mankiewicz came in and did, you know, a final polish on it. And that was great. And then Hamilton then was not able to do it. And they got Richard Donner to do it, which is, I think, a great stroke of luck. Because I think nobody could have done a better job than Richard. And I like Guy Hamilton personally a lot.
What is this a central theme for you in your films that has taken you through the different styles of filmmaking, but thematically,
if
stays the same?
When I was very young and was living in this little town in Texas, I once went to my mother and said, I know that we're related to everybody in this town, but I just don't know how we're related to everybody. And my mother had to sit me down and explain the difference in essence between family and community, and that family and by extension community as a kind of larger form of family has been a kind of preoccupation of mine, that our need of mine to find, to recreate, to measure my life by, to measure meaning by, or happiness by, to to meaning is a better word, that my sense of life is bound up with my relationships, primarily to my family and to my community. And that's the measure of what I think holds value in my life. I think if you live in New York now, I think, and this may not make any sense, most people have a value system that's vertical. Means a value system that I want the thing that's higher up the ladder. I think what I learned as a child is a value system that's horizontal.
That's what?
It's horizontal.
Horizontal.
That's about community. It's about community. It's about what matters to me is a need to be a part of a family, a part of a community. And it's a need on such a level that I'm not certain I was ever aware of it until it was pointed out to me by someone else. And that almost Bad Company is about a partnership, and it's an elegiac film about the ending of a partnership. An elegiac film about a partnership, about a friendship, done in the, ironically, at the very moment that partnership was ending. Okay? It has about it, I think, a kind of sadness. Because underneath it, I knew that was the ending of it. Late Show, as I said, is about my father. Still, and it's about trying to do a movie. Kramer is about my relationship with our son, that kind of relationship you have with a child, a father and a child at five. That is, it's the scene of them having breakfast without saying a word to each other. It's really a duplication of John and me. My wife and I have remained married for 46 years, 47 almost. But she tends to sleep later and the more stay up later and sleep later. And John and I would get up and we would have, and it would just, that scene where we wouldn't talk. And I think my relationship with my father, we would go on, he would say, do you want to go for a drive? And we'd go for a drive and we wouldn't say a word. But there was in it an enormous amount that happened that was never spoken. That I think, and this is maybe too elliptical, I think one of my biggest problems as a writer is I tend to say too much, and that I came from a father who said very little. And yet there was an enormous amount that was understood without having to say it. If I can learn more of that, I'd be a better writer. Does that make any sense? I am a really great believer in writing about something you know and that you understand.
But I think it's, people confuse that sometimes, write about what you know, but it's really write about what you understand and feel.
Yeah. No. I mean, my father was not a private detective, but there was something in that man that I could always say, yes, this is what my father would do. This is exactly what my father was, a loner. There's a scene in Late Show between Lily Tomlin and Carney where he says, I'm a loner. And it could have been a scene between my mother and my father.
Yeah. Is a piece of you in each of these films, or is there a film that you're
more than others? Some, there's very little of me in there's really little of me in Twilight, although I'm very proud of the movie. And in No Way's Fool, it was really about the community of living in a small town, and it was really about being poor. I really am uncomfortable with rich people. I'm really much more comfortable writing about or filming things about people who are poor rather than rich. I have no sympathy with the rich.
What for you is the distinction? How do you characterize?
I think if on top of everything else that you have to worry about in your life, if you're worried about money, then you're a human being. I don't mean making money. I mean surviving.
Survival.
If you are, I think being rich can cushion you from experience. Being rich and losing a child or losing a spouse is a horrible thing. That doesn't protect you on things like that.
Right.
But it does. You can generally, with 80% of life, allow yourself to be much more careless if you're rich than you can if you're poor.
How?
When my father died, he was from the 20s until he died, he always owed money to the bank.
He always had money?
Always. Yeah. Always. Good times and bad. Always.
How do you stay grounded in the entertainment business? Is there any advice you can give?
I'll say two things. One is that I have relatively few friends in the movie business. Most of our friends are people we know. It's one of the reasons I've lived in New York, because we know fairly few people in the movie business. Kazan once said, he liked to only use actors at the beginning or the end of their career. Otherwise, they did nothing but hang out with other actors. Two, I think, except for a few enormous stars, most people don't get paid that much in the movie business. They don't.
Right.
They get paid a lot sporadically, but when you average it out, they don't. They're not catastrophic. I mean, there are people like Spielberg who are enormously wealthy. I think he's done a very good job of remaining grounded. He works very hard. He's an enormously successful and good person. I think having a family is incredibly important in keeping you grounded in some kind of, you know, actual universe. And I think one of the great things that's happened with what's going wrong with the movie business is that people are gonna get paid less and make movies for less and have a better chance of making better movies. I think this is a hard time. I think it's the best time in movies. This really is a good time in movies. You're gonna see better movies coming out of this now.
That's so encouraging. Are you seeing it now? Are you already seeing a new trend as you felt as you were part of the vanguard in the 60s? Do you see a new trend now?
Not yet. I think it's too soon. I think I don't know how to judge the internet. I don't know how to judge all these new forms of things. I think that you're watching studios dying like dinosaurs.
Yeah.
I think a new distribution system will show up, and that will be the key. Mankiewicz used to say, there's no artistic breakthrough that's not been the result of something technical. It's somebody using a technical
thing.
And I think somebody who finds another distribution system that can work, and you can make movies for very little. If you can, you know, to make a movie on a cell phone would be great.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I'm not being funny.
I'm not laughing at it.
But I mean, I think that you can make 42-minute movies, and who knows what you would make with that? I think this is the sometimes you've got to blow up a neighborhood to rebuild it. And in this case, I think you're going to find radically different kind of movies coming out of this. I think it's going to be great.
Has technology changed your writing in any way?
I think I keep notes about things now, but they're not conventional movies. I don't know what they are, but I know now that I think they're on their way to being something that's something different. I think movies are the size they are and are shown the way they're shown because they had to adapt themselves to a theater format. Now that there's another technological format, which could be the internet, could be, I don't know what it can be, but different venues, then we can start to think not in a conventional 1, 2, and 3 act kind of a way of telling a story, that we can think of a 5-minute film like it was a poem, or you can think of it as like a question. Or you can think of it, it can change narrative itself. Imagine that. If your whole idea of narrative completely went out the window and you were able to reinvent what narrative is. I grew up in a small town in Texas, and in summer nights, families would gather in somebody's backyard. And they would have dinner, and the women would go inside and do the dishes and gossip, and the men would sit outside and smoke and occasionally have a beer and tell stories. And there were people who were great storytellers. And they would be a short story or a long story that could last. The object of the story was, it didn't matter if it was true. You would always say this was true, but some of them were clearly not true. Okay, they were just great storytellers. And that was a kind of art. A kind of extraordinary art. I mean, without wanting to sound obnoxious, it was Socrates who objected to writing, because he said then people wouldn't have to remember anything anymore.
Right.
It made you not have to remember. Like we say, computers make us not have to add anymore. Writing made us not have to remember things anymore. And there's something happening right now. I know that. I can't tell you what it is, but I have an instinct that something's happening. The great part about working at Esquire was we were always scrambling, looking to see what was the next thing that was going to happen. Because the life of the magazine depended on the next thing that was going to happen. It could be trivial and irrelevant, but we were always looking for that. And I think that sense of living in a dynamic world has come back into life itself. And it comes at a price, and it's a hard time.
It comes at a price.
It comes at a price because everything is unstable, unsettled. It's hard to get a picture financed, but it's in transition to something else, something new and something really much more exciting.
Kind of feel like the star child at the end of 2001. What is this new form going to be? My concern has always been that we get it down to such short bits of information that we lose storytelling in the process. You know,
there's just be a different kind. You will never lose storytelling.
Good.
You will. Storytelling. We are creatures who tell stories. That's what we are. But stories are with us from the beginning. I mean, I'm reading my way very slowly through the Hebrew Bible. I'm at the book of Isaiah, I read it so slowly, but from to imagine that it is a book that goes from the beginning to the end. And it's all a hodgepodge, but in some way it incredibly moving and makes extraordinary sense. And I think we sometimes have to loose the reins on existing forms to find something that we've never thought of before.
Yeah. You have to let go and still trust that the vehicle will keep moving in your state.
But something's going to happen. It's yeah. Something, you got to fade. Yeah. I've been incredibly lucky with the business people that I've been associated with. My first agent was a woman named Elizabeth McKee who taught me about Flannery O'Connor. My second agent was Gloria Sapphire who managed to get Bonnie and Clyde done. And she got us through a very dysfunctional part of our working relationship, partly by lending us money from time to time, and partly by struggling to get us work in whatever way we could, and she managed to help keep us afloat. And then Sam Cohen left her to go to Sam Cohen, and Sam
Cohen is you and David Newman.
It was just David and Newman, and then we went to Sam Cohen because Arthur Penn said you need to go to this guy, and Sam, I sometimes think that in fact I'm a fictional character from Sam's imagination. That I'd already done Bad Company by the time I got to Sam. The partnership was breaking up, and he is the one who made it possible for me to get Late Show. I'd been from not wanting to do Bad Company and being given Bad Company. Then when I wanted to direct, it was nobody wanted me to direct. And finally, he bludgeoned Altman into letting me do Late Show. And Altman really taught me to direct. Altman really taught me to direct. Hmm. And he told me to trust actors. He told me to stop trying to direct everything. You know, he said, let it happen, you know. He fired me 3 times in the course of the picture, but always hired me back. And it was a thorny relationship, but he was great, and I owe him a huge amount, more than ever can be put into words. And then Sam and Arlene got me Kramer. And then when I did Places, nobody would buy people after Kramer.
Places in the Heart.
After Kramer, a studio had came to me and said, I don't care what you do, just give it, I'll do it. I'll write you a check now. I'll do it. So I gave them Places. I can do any picture but this. And it was turned down by 3 studios. And finally Sam got the people, got Sidney Pollack, who was then creative head of TriStar briefly, to do Places in the Heart, because nobody else would have done it. And he again and again and again made it possible in new films that nobody would have done. None of those people, there was nothing venal about any of those people. I mean, I made a joke about Sam. I said, you know, Sam, I went to you because I wanted to be rich, and you wanted me to be an artist, but neither one of us succeeded. I've had one bad relationship with a producer, but except for that, I've had no bad relationship with my business.
What do you attribute it that? To what do you attribute that?
I have good luck, good fortune. I don't know. I'll tell you this. I had to do a test for a bad company. And Bud said, okay, they want you to test, but they're going to then, once you've done the test, they're going to say, we can't tell anything from a test. And they're going to give it to the producer, who was Stanley Jaffe. And so that's exactly what happened. I did it. And Stanley and I got along very well in the doing of the test. Evans, and Peter Brett was in the room. Evans said, Stanley, it's up to you. And Stanley said, okay, let's let Benton direct it. And I said, we went out to someplace in Westwood Village to have a hamburger after. Stanley said this thing, I've never forgotten it. He said, listen, there are two kinds of directors. There's a kind of director who's brilliant and an asshole. He's cruel to people. He goes over budget. He's arrogant. He's a son of a bitch, but he makes brilliant movies. And the moment he slips, the knives come out. There's another kind of director who's easy to get along with, who does movies on time and on budget, who's a pleasure to work with. He'll work forever. I said, I'm going to take column B.
What can you say to a young writer who wants to sort of learn from way too much wisdom out there? And has an inner voice. How do you balance your own voice and the need to learn structure as taught by this one, that one, or the other one?
I think I once got fired from teaching at Cooper Union. I was teaching magazine design. And what I was really trying to teach is voice, how to have a voice, how to find your voice. And that's a thing you can't teach. A voice is a gift from God. It's what it is. Some people get it, some people don't. Some people have perfectly wonderful lives without a voice, okay? Really, and to do really good work. There's some extremely good directors who have no voice, but they have a great deal of intelligence and a great deal of competence, and they know how to tell a script, but they don't have a voice. A voice is not essential. It's good, but you can't see. It's not for me to say I have a voice. It's for somebody else to say if I have a voice or if anybody has a voice. I think the most important thing is to teach yourself. Is to say, honestly, whether it's write or direct or what, or produce, what movie am I looking to do? What do I want to do? It may change. I started out by wanting to make new wave movies. I wanted to make American versions of Truffaut films. I've ended up being much more deeply influenced by Howard Hawks than by any other director. Hmm. I mean, Hawks, if you look at Rio Bravo, that's a study in family and community. Four guys, Dean Martin, John Wayne, Ricky Nelson, and Walter Brennan, with a little help from Angie Dickinson. That makes a family and a community. And that's what Hawks films are about. That's what the thing when I saw that in Hawks, that's when I began to incorporate Hawks in me. Because it answered some primary need. And you have to find what. If you want to make movies because you want to be rich, then you say, okay, I'm going to study the movies, I'm going to learn how to make movies that make me rich, and that's whatever it is. If you want to make movies that are personal, then you have to find your way. But you have to be relentlessly honest with yourself about what you like, and then you have to study them for yourself. Why do I like this movie? What is it? Sometimes it's silly reason, but they'll take you to someplace Well, and they'll take you to a place that defines who you are in a unique way. I think you can teach film, or you can teach storytelling, which is really basically what film is, in George O'Keeffe, the painter, studied painting in New Mexico, and she had a very, very good teacher who once told her that all painting boils down to the management of color on a two-dimensional surface. Now, that was before cubism and the destruction of the two-dimensional. But that was a very good advice. All movies are, finally, when you reduce it to its simplest form, is time management. You're in the time management business. That's what you are. You take an hour and a half, or 10 minutes, or 3 hours, in somebody's life, and you manage that time. And how well you manage that time is that's essentially what the craft is about.
I just jotted down keywords that popped up. Family, trust, empathy, pragmatism, faith, and time management. Is that a recipe?
Family and community, the extension of family. Faith, to the degree that I am a religious person. I'm a regular churchgoer. And my life has been shaped by my religious beliefs. Empathy, that's personality. Pragmatism, that goes back to Stanley Jaffe's column B. Essentially, I grew up with a father who, as much as I loved him, was one of the most deeply impractical people in the world. And I, much as I love him, I did not want to be impractical. I did not want to, and I chose the most impractical thing in the world. And I chose stupidly. And somehow, I was protected in my absolute stupidity.
You were protected?
Protected in some sense. I mean, why in this world should somebody who got fired from Esquire, who can't spell, who can't punctuate, who took a creative writing course in college and flunked it, end up a screenwriter? I don't begin to know. I can't promise you, I know.
Let me ask you a question. I'm sorry, it might be personal, I don't know if you want. You talk a lot about your father. Your mother's role?
She was pragmatic and she was practical. She was, in a very different way, a huge, huge, huge influence on me. Because she was incredibly practical. She was very religious. I don't think I became religious till after she died. My father had very few friends. He was a good man, but he had very few friends. He had no social skills. My mother had friends throughout that town. I had very different relations with either of those people. My father, in some way, taught me to be a director. He was nonverbal. He'd come into the house after work, and he wouldn't say if it was a bad day or a good day. You had to read that by what he didn't say. And he taught me to watch people's actions. He taught me our survival, because he had a terrible temper, depended on making sure we knew what was there without him saying a word. Does that make any sense?
It sure does. It sounds to me, if I may say that the time management is very important, and that's perhaps something your mother gave you.
Time management is to get rid of all the arty shit about movies.
Yeah.
To make movies down to what they are at their simplest core. At some moment, if you don't take painting and reduce it to its simplest part, if you don't take music and reduce it, you just stop having these. I'm a deep believer in the auteur theory, but I think it's been the most badly abused theory that's led to more crappy work and more sense of self-importance on the part of mediocre artists than I have ever seen. It's not for any of us to decide whether we have a voice or whether we're auteurs or not. It's just not. It is your job to go in and do the best you can do. That's all you can do. And do it with some sense of empathy for the people who you share the workspace with. That's the best we can do.